In a career spanning 16 years, the Foo Fighters have released 6 multi-platinum albums and won 6 Grammys. However, since their huge Wembley Stadium shows in 2008, it's been all quiet on the Foo's front. All that changed in early 2011 as the band returned to the UK to play a few intimate shows.
All my life I've been searching for something, something never comes. Least nothing, nothing satisfies. I'm getting close, closer to the prize at the end of the road. All night long I dream of the day when it comes around and it's taken away. Leaves me with the feeling, don't feel the most. Feel it come to life, well, oh yeah! Calm down, don't you reason. You're such a delicate wrist. And if I give it a twist, something to hold when I lose my grip. Will I find something in there to give me just what I need? Another reason to bleed. One by one hitting up my seat. One by one hitting up my seat. And if you open up wide, and if you let me inside, on and on, I got nothing to hide. On and on, I got nothing to hide.
When you're as successful as the Foo Fighters, you can make an album anywhere and anyhow you please. Never ones to do things by the book, for their 7th studio album, Wasting Light, the band used Dave Grohl's garage.
It's nice to not do the same thing over and over and over again. Especially after 16 years, it's like every album's been a little different from the last, and some people love some of our records, some people don't like some of our records. And I'm glad, because that means that there's some diversity in there, you know?
This is the garage where we actually did most of the recording. When I first moved into this house, I used to do demos here with this super shitty drum set that in this room sounded like a fucking Led Zeppelin record. It sounded so good.
I think that Dave's always looking for ways to keep the process exciting for everybody, and probably for himself. It seemed like every time we do anything, there's sort of a overarching theme to it, you know? This time the theme was do it in the garage and do it on tape and kind of pull it back a little bit like that.
This time around, I thought, you know, I want people to hear what it's like when the Foo Fighters play in a garage.
I love this record. The last couple of records, we've been working on this other dynamic, mid-tempo songs, and I like the more straight-ahead, hooky, heavy rock songs.
Set in time and well, but I don't wanna wait.
Blasting Light is the first Foo Fighters studio album since 1997's The Colour and the Shape to feature former Nirvana and original Foo member Pat Smear, now officially back with the band full-time.
It's nice to have Pat to be objective, you know, like, Chris and Nate and Taylor and I have been making Foo Fighters records for a long time, and before Pat came back to the band, he would always listen to them and be really honest about them. I love it. I think it's great. I think that's pretty cool. I don't think it's the best thing you've done, but I like it. You know, we always really paid attention to what he had to say because he knows what it's like to be in the band, you know?
I was in the studio every day. It's a small, very small room, the control room. There's not a lot of space to hang out, but Pat was there every day and just the most enthusiastic, just excited about everything, and you kind of need that.
The funny thing is, there's three guitar players in the band now, yet the drums are louder on this album than they've ever been on any album since I've been in the band. And it's because Dave kind of had this idea for this technique. If you listen to a song like Rosemary, everybody's kind of ping-ponging off each other and doing these single line things. And in actuality, it gave more space.
We all had like a specific kind of place in the song. I'm a rhythm guitarist. I play a guitar like it's a drum set. And Chris is a really rudimental, melodic guitar player. He could play just better than anybody else, basically. And Pat straps on a guitar and it becomes like a steamroller, you know? And all of those things together make for this one sound, and that's what we are.
Adding to the Back to the Roots flavour of the recording sessions was the band's choice of legendary Nirvana producer Butch Vig and the use of analogue tape to capture their raw energy.
I like the way we sound. I like it when I sing out of tune. I try really hard to make it sound good. That's as good as I can do. Our drummer is one of the best fucking drummers I've ever seen in my life. Why the fuck would I want to line him up like a Kraftwerk record?
This is where we did all the recording. The thing about using a tape machine is you can't manipulate the performance in a computer. If you have to edit anything, if you like the first half of this take, but you like the second half of this take, then you literally come out with the razor blade and do manual edits. Like this, see? This is probably one of Taylor's shitty drum fills that we didn't use for the record.
The first song we recorded, the tape started falling apart, started shedding. And everybody went into this panic. Oh, see, no, can't use tape. Tape doesn't work anymore. Can't, gotta use a computer. It's like, what the fuck? You know what we would have done 20 years ago if that happened? Get another fucking reel of tape, do it again. What's wrong with that? Oh, I'm sorry you have to play the song twice. You know what I mean? Like, it's not rocket science. So, it only made sense to do it that way.
Dave's like, if I see a fucking computer in the studio, besides your laptop, email, and friends, I'm gonna grab a baseball bat and I'm gonna smash it right in front of you. He's like, this is my house and there's no fucking computers to record on. We're doing it on tape.
As long as I've been playing music, I've only made a few records, like whole albums, and they've all been to tape. I'm just used to the tape anyway, that's all I know. So it was really comfortable for me.
On the way, Dave Grohl, the godlike genius and video director.
This is my method of directing.
That's right.
Minimalist. Cool. Let's do it one more time. Okay, the first time was better. Let's go.
...2011 sees the Foo Fighters back in business with a new album, Wasting Light, recorded the old-fashioned way on analog tape. In keeping with that, the first taste for the fans was an online-only video directed by Dave Grohl, shot on VHS and starring Lemmy from Motorhead.
I think we had one day, well, like a half a day for Lemmy. So we like flew him in and made sure his Jack and Coke was there and his Ruffles chips, and he eats, that's his lunch.
And got a friend dressed like him that could drive.
Yes,
because
Lemmy doesn't drive.
So,
would you want Lemmy driving you? Like a DUI a week.
Through a stunt double for that.
White Limo's like the dude at the party who's so fucking wasted you want to kick him out, but he's just too much fun.
When Dave directs it, he's not a stickler. He doesn't make you shoot each scene 8,000 times. You know, a normal video director, like, we need to get it from this angle and from that angle and do this, and, you know. Dave's like, we would shoot it twice, and he'd be like, okay, great, let's move on. What's next?
Right? It turned out okay. This is my method of directing.
That's right. Minimalist.
Cool. Let's do it one more time. Okay, the first time was better. Let's go. White Limo is a song on a new record that I don't really think anyone considered to be a single, except for Pat. After recording it, Pat's it. That's our first single. There it is. And then when we first started playing the record for people, that was the song that got the biggest reaction of them all. At one point, we were playing it for a room full of people, and this guy leans over to me and he goes, is that you singing? Yeah, it's me singing. What are you talking about? So I had this idea for the video, like, oh, that'd be hilarious if Lemmy were our chauffeur and we're landscapers, which if you've ever been to Los Angeles, the red pickup truck with the three landscapers in the back is like, that should be the state flag. And then Pat is the drug dealer. It was too easy, you know? And then my wife is like the Tawny Cotain of the Whitesnake video.
That'll be our best video for this album, for sure. We'll never top that.
I know, we'll spend
never
50 times as much on every other video.
We already did.
And I have to say, today, it's over a million hits on YouTube.
YouTube platinum status.
Yeah! Where's my plaque?
Standing here, I should.
band's trip to the UK wasn't only to preview the new album, but also for the Foos to talk up their documentary film Back and Forth, and for Dave Grohl to be acclaimed a godlike genius at the NME Awards.
Godlike Genius Award goes to Mr. Dave Grohl.
The award show was awesome. I don't think we shared that award with Dave. I think he just gets that himself.
I think it's sharing the moment, I think.
Is that, yeah.
Yeah.
Where's little godlike soldiers?
This one's for the drummers!
I don't think Dave's got a problem being the center of attention, but that's a tough center of attention. I thought it was cool that we actually went up there and played for 2 hours. Usually I get to people play like 4 or 5 songs and bugger off to the bowl.
The reason why we're the Foo Fighters is because of the people in the band. It's not just me, man. That first Foo Fighters record, that's not the Foo Fighters. That's just me. Foo Fighters is the 5 of us. And so if anyone were replaced with someone else, it wouldn't sound like us. We all belong here and make the band what it is. It's not just me. They fucking know that. I might be the person that has to like steer the ship and do the fucking talking sometimes and whatever, but of course it's not just me.
I feel like we really haven't had a lot of conflict the last 8 or so years. I mean, there's been little things. I mean, you stick 5 grown men together, acting like they're in high school, you know, putting their art project together, and I suppose there's always gonna be some little thing. But we didn't beat each other up, and we didn't break up after it either, which was kind of, you know, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, you know?
I'm glad that we've had conflict in the past so that we could make a good documentary.
Yeah, I'm glad our lives have been very painful at times, so that you guys could enjoy it.
While making the new album, the band's only worry was how to top their legendary 2008 Wembley Stadium shows.
Doing Wembley, I just thought, oh, we can't come back to England. We just fucking played to everybody. What are we gonna do? What do we do next? And our booking agent says, I know what you do next. Do the opposite of what you did last time. Start with the big show. Don't start with the arena tour. Start at the big place. And I said, are you kidding me? The balls do you have to do something like that? The audacity to just stroll in and say, all right, we're the Foo Fighters, we're back. And we're gonna play Milton Keynes now. And I was really nervous when the tickets were gonna go on sale. God, we don't even have a new record. We weren't even done with the new record. Mm-mm. It was terrifying. And the fact that they sold out like that, it was like, oh, wow. I guess that means they're still there. Our fans still want it. Like, they really like us. Easy for you to say. Your heart has never been broken. Your pride has never been stolen. Not yet, not yet. One of these days, I bet your heart will be broken. I bet your pride will be stolen. I bet. One of these days.
So after a roller coaster 16 years, the Foo Fighters are in a great place, both musically and mentally.
At this point, we really have to balance our lives with the band, you know. I want this band to last forever. I don't want to burn it out. Fortunately, we've gotten to that point in our career or in our lives as a band where we can say, no, we don't want to do that. And mostly what we do when we say that is we protect the band. We protect ourselves so that it'll last even longer. So the idea is to try to do as much as we can in the short period of time that we have, and then go home and remember why we love being in the band. The last 2 years that we took off reminded us of why we love to be in the band. Even when I was off playing in a band with a dude from Led Zeppelin, I missed being in the Foo Fighters, you know? This is where we belong. And when you come back to it with that recharge energy, you get an album like the one that we just made.
I think as far as albums since I've been in the band, it's, you know, the last couple records, some people may call it a slightly patchy, you know? Not that there was bad songs, but just songs that maybe didn't, they were a little bit schizophrenic on the record and it just didn't really kind of fit this or that. And maybe some songs weren't quite up to snuff as they should be. And I feel like this is the first record we made since I was in the band where every song is good. I'm really proud of it.
We just want to keep it alive, you know? If we ever say, I'm sorry, dude, we just don't want to do that. We're only saying that because we want to be around forever, you know?
The end.